welcome to this special Christmas Eve edition of Flights of Fantasy. I'm your host, George Wood. We promise that by the end of today's show, we will have violated every FCC regulation in existence. We're going to start right now with our fake TV rating. Nice, guys. Right over the logo. Actually, I don't think that's a violation at all, but this is public television, and hey, we can do what we want. Total and complete anarchy. TV 14 isn't usual for us, but today, we've just got to make some comments on, well, you'll see. I promise that no matter how old you are, even if you're older than me, you're really going to love today's show. We start with a live link to Santa as he delivers the toys tonight. Let's move on to Santa. Hey, Santa, what you doing there? Whoa, falling down that chimney. Well, come on, get off your butt and let's get on with it. Come on, show us what you've got. Where's the bag? Get that bag out. Come on, hurry, hurry. There we go. All right, toys for the little kitties. Look at here. Oh, somebody left us a gift. What's in the gift, Santa? Let's see what they left you. Open it. Look. Oh, wow. Sorry, we seem to have lost communication there. We also seem to have lost our snow. Wonder what was in the box? Well, did you see Pulp Fiction? Remember the suitcase at the end? No, just kidding. Now, in a fast, lame, and cheap segue, we're gonna move right on to two Nintendo 64 games for the holidays, Bomberman 64 and Diddy Kong Racing. What are the ingredients for the ultimate racing game? Take a car, airplane, and hovercraft, and stir vigorously with Super Mario 64 style graphics. Fold in a world-famous video game character named Diddy Kong, plus some appealing wannabes. Sprinkle in the overly sensational marketing term real-time dynamic animation. And finally, shake generously with a good old rumble pack. Oh, and one more thing. Top it off with a blue, clue-dispensing elephant genie who hails from India. Nintendo serves a large helping of juicy video game goodness to N64 fans with Diddy Kong Racing. The game features Rare's new exclusive real-time dynamic animation, which leverages the system's power by creating nice lighting effects and noticeably smoother, rounder, more realistic, and dynamically animated characters. The 8 licensed drivers in the game feature soft skinning, the process of taking a texture map and wrapping it around a polygon, instead of just painting a picture on a flat, jagged polygon. Diddy Kong Racing is a graphical feast, no question about it. But the gameplay is very similar to Mario Kart 64, with one exception, the one-player adventure mode. This feature has been way overhyped as explorative, but the only real exploration takes place in just two places. One, the overworld, which you can traverse in a few minutes. And two, the rare times when you will swerve off the racetrack to get a key or other item, which is practically in plain view. This can hardly be called exploring. The game's objective is for players to get first place in each race. Each race takes place on a different course. The game lets you pick from several races at a time, so you never get stuck in one area. Diddy Kong Racing basically has three things going for it. One, the bosses are totally cool. It will take several tries to topple the first boss, a gigantic Stegosaurus. Two, the challenge is high, with both the bosses and the entire game overall. Even easier tracks will require a little luck to finish first. Finally, number three is the 2-4 player mode. This mode is awesome because players spend more time setting up a sting where one person bombs another person just as he or she turns a corner than racing. Yes, each vehicle can be equipped with weapons. The game is all the better as a result. These 3 points compensate for the game's fairly short length, ultimately passing with a moderately enthusiastic thumbs up. Bomberman 64, however, gets a big thumbs down. The graphics are not up to par for the N64 in some levels. The control is nothing to speak of, and the game just isn't fun. Here's an example of a series that has to stay in the 2D format in order to have that addictive flair of fun. The 3D format just totally blows the whole game. Complaint number one, your little Bomberman character runs around too slow even when you're pushing the control stick full throttle. Complaint number two, the game doesn't feel very puzzly for a puzzle game. In fact, that's just it. This isn't really a puzzle game. It's a sacrilege to the series. This is one of the few series that can't stray too far from the original formula without creating a total disaster. Players will quickly get sick of running around the sparse 3D worlds in search of enemies to bomb. The only puzzle element is that sometimes it's hard to find out how to get to a particular enemy. The multiplayer Bomberman mode is true to the original, but only a handful of stages are available. The main meat of the game is that darned one-player adventure mode. Nintendo needs to stop calling everything an adventure mode, especially when the game is about as adventurous as a trip to Kmart. We have to confess, since we've done the review of Diddy Kong Racing, the game has grown on us even more. It's surprisingly challenging. It's definitely worth buying. Okay, enough pandering to Nintendo. We've really been itching to do this. Get ready. Here's our list of the worst movies of the year. Yeah, you might think we're stupid, but hey, we've got our own show, so just stuff it if you disagree. The Full Monty stinks, Boogie Nights is a flop, and Pamela Lee Wired was atrocious. Okay, that last one was a fake, but geez, if it did exist, it couldn't be any worse than the other two. Speaking of movies, since we love to rate things, here are our nominations for the Flights of Fantasy Film Awards. For Best Picture, Amistad, Contact, G.I. Jane, The Ice Storm, and Titanic. For Director, James L. Brooks, As Good As It Gets, James Cameron, Titanic, Neil LaBute, In the Company of Men, Ang Lee, The Ice Storm, and Robert Zemeckis, Contact. For Best Actor, Matt Damon, Good Will Hunting, Daniel Day-Lewis, The Boxer, Leonardo DiCaprio, Titanic, Aaron Eckhart, In the Company of Men, Peter Fonda, Yulee's Gold. For Best Actress, Helena Bonham Carter, The Wings of the Dove, Jodie Foster, Contact, Pam Grier, Jackie Brown, Demi Moore, G.I. Jane, and Kate Winslet, Titanic. For Best Supporting Actor, Robert Forster, Jackie Brown, Brandon Hammond, Soul Food, Anthony Hopkins, Amistad, Al Pacino, The Devil's Advocate, and Billy Zane, Titanic. For Best Supporting Actress, Kim Basinger, L.A. Confidential, Allison Elliott, The Wings of the Dove, Journey Smollett, Eve's Bayou, Sigourney Weaver, The Ice Storm, and Vanessa Williams, Soul Food. For Original Song, Journey to the Past from Anastasia, and My Heart Will Go On from Titanic. We'll have the rest of our nominations next time. Stay tuned to the end of the show for a magical musical montage to Titanic. If any of you out there don't go see this movie just because you don't want to sit in the theater for 3 hours, well, I hope you die a slow and painful death over exactly 3 hours. This movie is excellent, and it needs to be seen on the big screen. Starship Troopers, on the other hand, is simply a good renter, and it's in the theaters now.
In the future, wars will still be fought for honor, glory, and survival. Only the enemy will change.
We must meet the threat with our very lives. To ensure that the human civilization dominates its galaxy always.
So begins Starship Troopers, a hugely entertaining, mega-budgeted sci-fi yarn by Paul Verhoeven, who's making quite a recovery from his 1995 G-string flop Showgirls by going back to his filmmaking roots. Starship Troopers qualifies as cinematic junk food, but that's forgivable when the junk food is this tasty. Everyone needs a high-calorie change of pace from Fall's onslaught of costume dramas and other assorted Oscar bait, and Starship Troopers does the job admirably, despite its flaws. Based on the 1959 Robert Heinlein novel about interstellar war with giant intelligent insects, Starship Troopers follows a group of friends beginning with their sheltered years at school through their wartime experiences.
Commanded by fate to defend humankind.
Everyone fights, no one quits.
The first half is something like a cheeky, futuristic hybrid of Saved by the Bell and G.I. Jane. This futuristic soap opera's exposition is silly, but aware of its own ridiculousness to merit more smiles than groans.
Boy meets girl.
I don't want him to get in the way of my career.
Boy loses girl.
She winds up falling for someone else.
Boy gets another girl.
I'm, you know, hopelessly devoted to him.
And boy eventually gets back to the other girl.
So we have that love triangle thing going on.
Once we get past campy character introductions and tons of macho training sessions, Starship Troopers really kicks into high gear. The last half is gruesomely violent action. A fury of severed limbs, decapitations, disembowelments, explosions, and other jolt inducers that are really going to please the 13 to 14-year-old boys who dodge getting carded on their way to this deservedly R-rated show. The creature design and special effects are as amazing as expected, and their interaction with the human actors is a realistic, imaginative high point. Phil Tippett, the special effects master known for bringing personality to his fantasy creatures, designed the bugs. The arachnids are a spider, scorpion, crab combo that are all sharp talons and even sharper legs. Really cool.
What we're trying to achieve is a palpable feeling of weight and mass and a lethal quality that will allow them to feel like they are moving quickly but still have scale.
The sequences of insect warfare are numerous, bloody, and immensely satisfying. The occasional dramatic moments are botched due to the lack of any strong, outstanding characters. These bland and impossibly good-looking Ken and Barbie archetypes serve the story adequately enough to keep distractions at arm's length, but they restrain the film from reaching Star Wars' lofty heights, where even the slightest alien had personality. Most of the performers hail from the Aaron Spelling School of Acting, Beverly Hills 90210 and or Melrose Place, and it shows. Casper Van Dien, for instance, from One Life to Live, is perfectly likable but limited. One of the best casting calls of the movie is having Doogie Howser star Neil Patrick Harris play a telepathic military officer, a small but juicy role. Starship Troopers is everything a solid B-movie should be, trashy, fun, and full of monsters. It's a true guilty pleasure. So there you have it. This movie is really stupid, but we liked it anyway.
Hey, George.
Yeah?
I've been thinking, you probably know what I'm thinking.
Do it now?
Yeah, I think so.
Are you really sure?
Yes, I'm sure.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, we're pleased to announce we're going to bring out the big guns early. We're really excited about showing you this awesome song from the video game Discworld 2. Get ready to croak.
There's a place you're always welcome, that's as nice as it can be. Everyone can get in, 'cause it's absolutely free. That's death. No need to take a breath, just lie around all day with not a single bill to pay. Hooray, that's death. No more sicknesses or flu. If you've lived beyond your means, you can die beyond them too. Boo-hoo. Well, the greatest and the finest have already died. Why not simply join them on the other side? That's death. Say farewell to all your bills, rip up all your wills, and pop your final pills. Amen, that's death. It's a tete-a-tete with fate. If you're not feeling great, then it's the best way to lose weight, mate. Nothing here to hurt you, no one's here to nag. Come die with me if your life's a drag. That's death. For wealthy and well-bred, all of them are here, completely dead.
So dead.
millions who died. No one came back to complain. You can't take it with you. You can't keep what you've got. So why not just lie back and simply rot? Just simply rot. It's so cool, it's hot. And that's death.
We hope you're not in a holiday depression, but that was so hysterical, we just had to show it to you. Anyway, it all goes downhill from here. In cheap segue number two, we have a little factoid to take you into our commercial break.
I hang out with a pretty trashy circle. The circle that helps this circle by recycling trash.
Psych, just kidding. Since it's Christmas, our gift to you is no commercials. Nada, zip, zero. Except maybe at the end. Oh, wait a minute, guys.
Yeah?
Put that face up on the screen again.
Okay. Yeah. What?
Who was that woman? Was that Paul Newman's wife? She looks familiar to me, but I can't place her. Well, do you think that violates FCC regulations?
What?
You know, using a PSA not as a PSA?
I don't know.
Just... Well, anyway, ladies, prepare yourselves for the next segment. This show is rated TV-14, so any of you who can be stereotyped as a Republican and have young children in the room, prepare to take action. Here's our review for Tomb Raider 2. It's no big surprise that Eidos is moving up the video game food chain considering last year's mega hit Tomb Raider. The sequel uses the same formula to great success, with minor control changes for sidestepping and, of course, all new worlds and vehicles. The game starts off with a peek at ancient China. A dragon attacks the Great Wall, and a soldier notices a dagger embedded in his chest. Oddly, removing the dagger results in the dragon's death. Weird. You play Lara Croft, complete with front-loaded anvils, searching for the dagger centuries later. Your path to the dagger will take you just about everywhere, and that snow speeder kicks a major you-know-what. Tomb Raider has slightly more action than exploration this time around, but you may not notice the difference. This is good, because that way everybody's happy. Obviously, we're giving Tomb Raider 2 a good review. We fully expected to do so. We knew the game would be great, and it is, and we've only just scratched the surface. In answer to Lara's giant earrings, however, we have a challenge to Eidos. In Tomb Raider 3, create a storyline in which Lara gets breast cancer. Imagine the drama of a vulnerable Lara Croft still persisting in her worldly adventures despite her illness. It needs fleshing out, no pun intended, but we guarantee the gaming world would be shocked, stunned, and moved at the effort to make Lara's character more meaningful. We love Lara, but it's about time the industry had a big shock for a change. It's no shock that Tomb Raider 2 is excellent. Everyone should buy it. Period. The end. Okay, first things first. We don't mean to make light of breast cancer at all. We are serious about our proposed storyline and feel they can actually develop a story around her treatment without changing any game mechanics. We've got more absolutely ridiculous marketing to boys tactics in our next batch of reviews. Here it is. Crystal Dynamics builds on the success of last year's Pandemonium with Pandemonium 2. The biggest change this time around is the main female character, probably as a result of increased babe awareness in the video game industry. Think Tomb Raider's Lara Croft. Nikki has undergone a complete makeover. She's much more, well, endowed. Yes, the trend is getting obnoxious, but this is only the beginning, folks. I wonder if there's a limit to the size of those things. I guess there's no limit to the imagination. If you think we're the ones who have the imagination, then you're mistaken. The knobs in question are noticeably bigger, and it's for a reason, to entice gamers. You can only tell the relative size in two places, though, the package design and the full motion video sequences. The game itself depicts your character too small to see anything major. Pandemonium 2 is kind of fun because you only have to worry about control in one horizontal plane. The game looks like it would have 3D control, but it doesn't. And we're not complaining, because the chances are the control would have sucked if it was 3D anyway. Instead, the camera moves around the world to expose the areas as we run through them. This technique allows us to enjoy the vast spaces and wild landscapes as we play the game. You can play Pandemonium 2 with either the female character or the male counterpart. You can even switch between characters after you finish a level. Nikki, the girl, has her own set of special moves, while Fargus has another set. These moves include fireball attacks, spin attacks, and as the full motion video demonstrates, a Sid attack. Sid is the strange talking talisman that you throw at enemies to blast their butts off the screen. Pandemonium 2 requires a lot more practice and carefulness than it looks. In that respect, the game is challenging. Dedicated gamers should eventually beat it, and many players may find similarities to Crash Bandicoot 2's obstacle course-like levels. Pandemonium 2 is not the greatest game in the world, but it's decent fare with no one particular fault. It's an average game, if only due to the superiority of cousins Crash Bandicoot and Mario 64. Puzzle game fans may get excited over Intelligent Cube from Sony, although we don't see why. The game is simple by design and complex in execution. In other words, it's hard to beat, even though you're not doing much. All you do is mark a space on the floor, let a cube fall on it, then activate the marker to zap the cube. Puzzle games are just meant to tease the brain, but we still can't help but wonder why the cubes need to be zapped. Maybe we're plot crazy, but it'd be nice to know why the heck we're destroying rolling cubes of all things. The look of the game reminds us of Qbert. We didn't like that, and we don't like this. It gets old in 5 minutes. And so does Cool Borders 2. Although the control has some basis in snowboarding physics, we still don't feel the action at all. The game is about as immersive as Pong. Nothing feels natural. You press and hold X to charge your jump. Only when you let go of X does the jump occur. Whether this correlates to snowboarding or not, it's still awkward. You can't change direction while charging, and you can never see a hill in time to charge up for a big jump off it. Also, 90% of the steering is done with sharp turns that are hard to control. The game has more modes than Carter has pills. A competition mode, a half-pipe mode, a freestyle mode, a big air mode, a board park mode. Modes, modes, modes. What about a better game mode? The whole business of performing tricks is too much of a focus in the game. You can't succeed in any of the decent modes unless you take the time to learn the stunts. All of the courses are poorly designed and very boring, leaving little left to speak good of. There is just one highlight. The narrator from last year isn't as tripped up on saying the word cool like a surfer dude 12 million times in a row. The only real reason Cool Borders was even made is to reel in all those college-age skiers. Skiing is very popular with that crowd, and the game comes out just as college kids are getting their semester break. Perfect timing. Jet Moto 2 is slightly better than Cool Borders 2. Can you tell? This is the year of the sequels. The controls are basically the same as Cool Borders 2, but with different button arrangements. The game also has all that physics stuff that we never feel. The controls are a little better, especially with analog, but to turn corners, you need only tap the thumbstick slightly. Just nudge it. The game doesn't have weapons like Diddy Kong Racing, but the turbo boosts are much longer than in Diddy's game. With only 10 new tracks, Jet Moto 2 is just another tired sequel that everyone should pass on. Lastly, Parappa the Rapper is the only game in this batch that gets a full thumbs up. Pandemonium 2 gets even thumbs, the others all down. Most remarkable about this little gem is that there's an actual plot that sets up each musical number splendidly. Despite the game's low number of stages, each one will take a very long time to master. Not only do you have to repeat the instructor's rap, you have to do it in the same rhythm. This is easier said than done. We feel the game chops off our words unfairly as we play. This results when you're not in rhythm, but I tell you, I was in rhythm. I can keep a beat. Blathering about Parappa is pointless. The best way to get an idea of what the game is like is to just listen. Take it away, Parappa.
Everything, everything.
You have never sold everything, everything.
Money, money, money is all you need.
Money, money, money is all you need.
Money, money, money is all you need.
Do you know why we stopped the car?
Do I know why we stopped the car?
Yes.
Yes.
What?
What?
I forgot to close the door.
You forgot to close the door.
Now just don't forget, this ain't Kung Fu. Come on again. Check and turn.
Well, we've gone crazy today, but so many people have told us we needed to loosen up that we decided to grant them their wish. Let us know what you think about my antics and if you still think I'm an old fart. Our address is Old Fart, 45 Flights of Fantasy Way, Znot Fun, New York, 10036. Okay, the real address is BCTV, care of FOF, 2614 Kenhill Drive, Bowie, Maryland, 20715. Before we go on our much-deserved vacation, we've got a really cool trivia question for you. In Earth years, which is the only possible decade in which the movie Star Wars could have occurred? A, the 1850s, B, the 1980s, C, the 1990s, or D, the 2100s? The answer is A. Star Wars takes place in the past, a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Gotcha, didn't we? Lastly, in a ripoff from Comedy Central, what did we learn today? Number one, Santa makes an extra $200 a year from doing live Christmas Eve telecasts. Number two, the video game industry has gotten way out of hand in marketing to the male half of the species. And number three, absolutely nothing about FCC regulations. Well, listen, folks, I hope you have a great Christmas. We'll leave you with Titanic. I'll see you next year.
Spaces between us, you have come to show you.